Ashakum.
Ashakum.
Our speaker for this morning is our sister Aladasa, and she will speak to us on her relationship to the path and the Dristis. Sister Aladasa. I would like to say, Assalamualaikum first, to put myself in peace and to give you peace. And I would like to say, Rashaka Ma'at again, so we can really get this divine spirit in peace together. So Rashaka Ma'at.
Thank you.
Can we have a moment of silence, please? So I can get myself together.
Thank you.
It is an intervention in our mind to try to work the practice daily and be in the practice all the time. And that is a place that we need to stay at all the time. And I'm speaking for myself that that's a place where I need to stay constantly. I have to read this every time that I come to do my practice because as Bharataji did his satsang, I'm talking to Aladasa, because Aladasa is the one that needs the critical surgery. So this is what Aladasa has to read all the time to keep her reminded and grounded on what I have. I know I have grace, and I'm trying not to be emotional in here, but this is where I am. The characteristics of a master and a disciple. And I have to remind myself all the time because a lot of souls walk the earth and don't get a chance to have a master. I hope you can understand me through all this crying, but I'll settle down. And I have to understand what I have in my midst, and I have to understand what I have in the Sangha, and never get busy on what I need to do for myself. Okay. excuse me. Number one, this is the characteristics of a master, and I know it's all here, and I have to keep reminding myself. He must have had a master before, master himself before he can disciple. He must have traversed the past in order to be able to guide others, which is all Gurdwara. He must be accomplished, refined, and educated, and trained in good manners and courtesy in order to be embodiment of good manners and courtesy to others. And you know, he gives us all of that constantly. Well, he, and I'm going to be personal, he gives it to me all the time. He must have no need for his disciples' wealth. And, you know, Grisal will tell you quickly, you know, this path is to help us, and our wealth is really not nothing that he needs. If he can teach disciples by indirect illusion, and hence, he should not teach them through direct verbal explanation. Now, this hit me when I read it again because the last conversation that I had with Grisal, he said, you know, Bilal caught you on tape. And I said he did. It was one of the times that I nodded out when I should have been paying attention. So I said, okay, that was a soft tap that I got from him. You know, I had my, like one of the brothers said, I had my lap time, so I had to get slapped. I got some slap time, you know, to wake me up. Okay. He should have previously practiced and experienced what he has previously preached. He has previously preached. He must have already renounced and denied himself of ever he instructs others to abstain from. 10. He must not cast off a disciple whom he has accepted for the sake of God because of the disciple's bad human nature. Okay? Now this is concerning me. This is concerning the sincere disciple. This is all directed toward me. And they got he, so I'm going to go she. She must be clever in order to be able to understand the hint and indication of the master. So we must be attentive, because when Gurusab give us stuff, and you know, sometimes it may be in a roundabout way, but it's still a factual information, and we must be clever to what he's telling us. She must be obedient to his master in order to execute all his orders. Okay, the order of phone sangha, the order of getting up and saving practice, the order of doing seva, the order of just being kind to every sentinel beings, the order of maintaining the vows that I've taken. She must be alert in order to maintain the meaning of his words. She must have an enlightened heart so as to receive the spiritual eminence of her master. Now, I'm still working with that because I don't have that yet. I'm still trying to have an enlightened heart. I'm struggling with that as we speak because I don't know any better. I'm still very much unconscious. She must be honest and straightforward in speech so that he can be counted on to report honestly all to her heart. Still working with that one. I'm struggling very hard. Because sometimes I'll get choked up or I won't say nothing and I need to talk. And I don't. So I have to become honest and straightforward in my speech. She must keep her word. That's another thing I'm struggling with. Trying very hard to keep my word intact because that's all I have. All this other stuff is meaningless. But my word, as we know from elder brothers and from outside, that's all we have, and that's our bonding piece, so that she can be trusted to keep her commitment. She must be of detached and liberated disposition to be able to give away, if necessary, all her possessions. Oh my. Oh my. That's a very hard struggle. I have to read this one again to me. She must be of detached and liberated disposition to be able to give away all, if necessary, all her possessions. I want to get there. You know, I really do right now. I'm struggling. I want to give away and then I want to hold back. I want to give and say, well, okay, I can use that some kind of way. Or maybe I can hold it till I give it to somebody else. And it's still being attached, which is not being a good disciple. She must be discreet and able to keep her counsel, to be able to conceal the mysteries. I'm still struggling with that. And I get into my budget, my inner vision. I have to learn how to keep good counsel so I can hear what's going on, what's supposed to be coming to me. She must be receptive to the counsel and advice of others, to accept her master's counsel. She must be fearless, self-denying, and chivalrous in nature and be able to sacrifice even her very own life on the spiritual path. That one from my Islamic upbringing, I'm teetering in that. I think I could be chivalrous, and that's a could, because I still don't know who I am to sacrifice my life for the spiritual path. Okay. Now, I'm going to get into my relationship to the path. And I was looking at the tape for June 14th when he did the Father's Day tape, and he talked about, the master talked about the Avias. Am I pronouncing this correctly?
Louder.
Talk louder.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Aviasa, am I pronouncing this correctly? My brothers and sisters?
Yes, that's close enough.
Okay. And I want to do the practice. I'm saying I want to do the practice, but do I really want to do the practice? Because I struggle with this. I struggle with this on a constant basis. When I came to the path, I told my sponsors, I said 3 o'clock is not a problem because I automatically get up at 3 o'clock and I always ponder, oh Allah, why do I get up at this time? But the message didn't come. I said, okay, I know why I get up at this time, because I had these two babies and I'm clocked in. But it didn't have nothing to do with it. So when I got the correct message, then that's when I freaked out. I didn't want to get up at 3 o'clock. That's when I had to sit my behind still. You know, 3 o'clock will come, the eyes will go open. I didn't have to have a clock because this is the natural body clock in me to get up at that time. So when I got the message that, you know, you have to sit down, be still, and go in, I still struggle with that. To the day, I struggle with that. And I know that this is something that I must do. And I'm not consistent with it. Sometimes I can get up, it's no problem, go right into the practice, go right into to budget. And then other times, this mind will take me into orbit. And I'd be fidgeting and going all kind of way and thinking about what I got to do at school, and have I talked to Roosevelt, and did I do the right things with my girls, instead of being focusing with God. I know the reason why I have to be there at 3 o'clock, because that's my personal time with God. But this other side, this side that struggle constantly, it's taking me into another zone. And that's my battle all the time, the practice. And from the tape, I learned about the three dristis, and I have to look at my sister for this because I want to pronounce it correctly. And the first dristi he talked about was, is it Bada? Bada? Come on, help me.
Ba'ada.
Okay, having the experience. I know that's what that means. And from time to time, I do have experiences that'll shift me. But do I stay shifted? Because, you know, you can get so comfortable, like old shoes or old clothes, you want to go back and run back to that old habit. So I want to experience the experience and then stay there, you know, knowing, like Guru Sahib said, I'm already taken care of. Everything is in divine order. I know this, but do I actually know it? Unconscious still. Still trying to find my way through. And the happiness part, yeah, sometimes I go and I want to seek this happiness, and okay, if Roosevelt do this and the girls do that for me, and my school do that for me, I'm gonna get this right. Because it still goes inside of me, all the happiness. And all that other stuff is really mundane issues. I know that happiness is something that is, if it's going to be found, it's within the practice and within inside me and no other place. And the connectedness with my master, with his guidance. Do I pay attention to that all the time? No. Because I go unconscious. I fall asleep. and I go searching again until I get slapped back into reality because that suffering comes. Then I say, okay, leave that alone. Understand, God is in control. You don't run nothing. Just go through the experience. Okay. Also, in viewing the tape, I know in this life, I really, and by me starting, I probably don't have a chance to become enlightened. But I will say this. I'm going to go out struggling. I'm going to struggle, fight for this enlightenment until, you know, the Bardos come. Probably going to be struggling with that and probably don't want to go. But at least I'll have an understanding, hopefully, when that comes. The second one that he talked about is Mentia. Okay. The death situation. Oh. That's still a hard pill for me to swallow. And in science, I know for a fact that these cells are dying constantly. But the reality of it all, am I conscious to understand it? No. Because I still think that I'm 20 or 15 and it's getting ready to be 50-year-old body. And if the equation is wrong, I have to surrender that this body is dying. I have to. But sometimes I go unconscious and want to do things outside of that. And then I suffer. I go into the mode of fallacy mode. I want to pretend or be somewhere else than I'm not. So I want to, you know, I'm trying to obtain rational understanding. So I won't be in the fallacy mode. And sometimes I go in and out of that. Sometimes I have a great understanding, okay, you know, birth and death are twin halves. You know you have to leave out of here. What's important to you? You have to go today, Aladasa. What are some of the things that you would do? When that first question was posed to me, I was so way out, I'm going to do my obituary. How you going to do an obituary and you know you're getting ready to leave? I was so way out, I said, well, I'm going to tell my daughters I'm going to do this and do that and all this other stuff. Still meaningless. But what I have come to understand, I still got to go in. And everything else will take care of itself. I go in. Become and understand what the process is going on, then my girls and Roosevelt will have a complete understanding of what's happening. And maybe they won't. And the last one, Dosh, is it? Dosh? Dosh? This one, this one right here just really, really made me sit up because I'm responsible for all my suffering. No, this can't be. This goes to somebody else. I'm not responsible for all my suffering. I don't, you know, no. Somebody else did this to me. But now I understand that all my suffering belongs to me, because sometimes I have these conversations in my head that I'm going to say to somebody and it didn't even happen. I'm having this pre and post conversation, all right, but I'm going to do this and do that and all this other stuff. Creating my suffering, you know, just really making me suffer. because this might not even happen at all. I'm so delusional and just an illusion about, okay, if I do this, then this will happen. But if it don't act right, I'm going to go here and do that. All an illusion because none has ever happened. I'm not even in the present. Not even taking care of business or right at hand. So I suffer. Suffer from my delusionary state of being not present in the moment. Not paying attention to who I am. Not understanding moment to moment that things are happening to me. Don't suffer with it. Mama Hart said, let it roll off your back, Aladasa. Okay, right. Matter of fact, I was mad with Mama Hart. I said, Brother Bri, I don't want to talk to you right now. Because he told me, he said, let it go. Let it go. And maybe you were like that. And I said, he's not talking what I want him to say to me. But he said exactly what he was supposed to say to me. But this was after. So I made myself suffer. And suffering can really make you mentally crazy for a second, because suffering makes you repeat the stuff over and over and over. And you might get hit by a car and you're still on that same repetition. They did this to me and I'm going to get them back and blah, blah, blah. So you have to come back. And that's why saying the mantra to me is so, so important. My final thing before I get into some of my reading, I know I am deeply in denial and I want to become conscious. I know I am deluded. I know that I have things that I need to do to stay in the practice. I need to be committed, not straddling the fence on my vows that I gave, my commitment. I need to be consistent in my commitment, not to no one else, but to myself. I have something here that I thought that I have to read constantly too. Being associating with the ocean, becoming the disciple of a master. I don't like how this begins because I don't choose a master. Master chooses me, but I'm going to read exactly what it's saying. Choosing a master for oneself is like seeking to associate with an ocean. To be able to sit at the feet of an ocean requires an individual with an ocean-like heart who can receive whatever comes from the ocean wholeheartedly. Those who come to the ocean must be conscious of the following points. One. The ocean is besieged by all kinds of storms, which one should not fear. That is, the disciple should not be offended by the harshness and anger of the master, but rather see both the grace and the wrath of the master as one and the same, loving both. Can we do that? Can I do that? Number two. The ocean is full of rapacious sharks, which also should not be feared. Number three, the law of the ocean are different from the moral laws of the earthly world. This means that the master is above and beyond the good and evil, which are concepts of the people of the world. As the poet Majarbi puts it, what is unbelief to the society is our religion, The salty bitterness of the world is so sweet to us. Number four, if the behavior and attributes of the master are not acceptable to the disciple, this is because the latter lacks the master insight and incapability of understanding his words. This is the meaning of expression. The master's unbelief is the disciple's faith. That is to say, the true disciple is one who has faith in the master's unbelief, sincere, that whatever the master does, he knows what he is doing. Thus, the sincere disciple never questions the master. Number five, the disciple should never accept the ways and methods of the world from the ocean. To put it in another way, the disciple should not impose on the master the habits and customs to which he or she is attached. The danger is that if disciples measure the master's action against their own expectation, they will start having objections. Number six, on the path or in association with the ocean, one should not be anxious about anything that befalls one, but rather should tolerate whatever comes to one, accepting it fully. In as Marabi puts it, don't ask about the approach of the seminary or the method of the kalab. Pass beyond the approach and the method. When you step with sincerity on the path, leaving your head behind, if they steal your hat away, don't ask about it. Inner path. If we wish to enter our house, we must first try to find its door. The door of our real home is behind the eye, is behind the eyes in reticular teal, the third eye or the single eye. To open it, we have to knock repeatedly on the door. Is that what we do every day? Isn't that what we do when we go into budget? We knocking at that door? I know I do. I'll try to. I'm making an effort to knock. This knocking on the door means that we reverse the flow of our sacrifice attention and focus it on the eye center. When by doing this repeatedly, the attention becomes concentrated at the third eye, the door opens and we cross the threshold of the house. The path opens up when we connect our consciousness with the divine melody, and this path leads us home. That's not the path. I'm going to end it by saying that I'm truly blessed to have this honor and grace of coming to the house to have a master, to be reborn. You know, Christianity says, you know, born again Christian, and you know, Islam have their method of rebirth, but this is truly the rebirth here, because as I have told some of the Redoxes here, this is the only place that I know or have been to in life that have really put my whole self in check. Dietary, mental, verbal, emotional, love, being conscious of everything. This is the place. And I feel truly honored and blessed that I'm learning how to love, how to be honest, learning how to be woke and staying in the moment, how to go inner and have a conversation with God. How to even love my new gift of my husband, Roosevelt, because I don't even know how to do that. You know, I have a gift here. This is something that I didn't think would happen to me again, but I have a gift. And if I pay attention to my master and the sun god and what I have here, then I think my travels or the journey that I have on this side will take me where I need to go. I'm going to say assalamu alaikum and my shaykh. Is it any questions? Yes, sir.
What was that first book you read?
The first book is my Sufi book, Under the Sufi Cloak. And you're welcome to read it if you want to. I always refer back to this because, you know, by me, my background being Islam. And I think I talked to you about this. I had a brother that practiced Sufism, and when he said, well, you don't have to do your prayers, I said, this boy has gone crazy. And he said, well, you know, you can just sit and practice. I'm saying, you know, this was maybe about 10 years ago. And I said, my brother has really gone off the deep end. But he wasn't. I just didn't. It wasn't my time to hear this. And now I'm hearing it because he had this very book and I said, now, you know, what is Sufi, what's that? What is that? But that's still leading to the path and leading to the inner working of the spirit. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Why did you choose this book?
I chose that topic because I'm still wrestling with this life that I'm having. All that I told today or was talking about, I'm still having a very hard time. So I chose it because it's really I'm talking to myself, even though I'm talking to the sun again. I have to repeat everything I say on self on a constant basis because I don't know anything. I don't even, you know, I'm here presently now, but I'm not here. And I want to understand how to get here, how to get in the moment, how to use all the tools that was given to me, how to know the death process, how to understand that nothing in this lifetime makes me happy, how to know that I make my own self suffer, how to use the sun god. No. So did that answer your question? The thristies and my relationship to the past.
Kind of
oh, I'm sorry. Ooh, you know, please forgive me.
Share something with you from my own experience, you know, about the marriage with your husband. There's 3 points I'd like to make.
Okay.
Bruised up, because I've had several marriages. And I could have made any one of them work it that know then when I know now. And he told me marriage is a ministry. And you take vows, which cannot be. I mean, you might violate them, but you pay. But you must minister to the partner, whether they minister to you or not. That's on them. That's their vows. You understand what I'm saying? This helps to make you a good person. You have to be a good person. Okay? And you can play with that one. The other one is attachment. There's one owner of everything and everyone. And it's not who we think we are generally. We're becoming. That one is being, which is beyond becoming. It's an absolute condition. And we'll have insights and glimpses of that. But that's where the faith or the trust comes in. And finally, dying for spirituality, about giving your life. It's like we don't appreciate our life because we're appreciating it from the animal perspective, basically, you know. And there's only one life, and we all share it, you know. And when you see that, the courage comes. Nobody wants to die in any sense of the word. But if you haven't found anything worth living for, then you don't deserve to live. You know, and I just wanted to share that with you.
Well, you know, I thought about that because I struggled with our relationship before we got married. I said, okay, well, why are you doing this? Because my first marriage was an out-of-town brother. I said, okay, what lesson am I supposed to learn? So I talked to Bruce before I got married, and he told me, he said, you know, this was before I got my big name.
What you talking about?
Oh, I'm sorry. And you know what? Generally, I'm loud, so you know I must be really cowered down here. Before I got my big name, he said, okay, Deborah. He said, with this marriage, when you go into it, he said, you can't look left or right. And for most part, he said, don't try to guru this brother. He said, you tried that in the past, didn't you, beloved? And I'm going, how did he know this, you know? So I got married to him, and respecting everything that Guru Sahib has told me. Because looking left or right for me, that's going back in the past. You know, if I look that way, I'm going, okay, I'm going to do this because I tried that one that time. But looking straight ahead, you have promise, you know that you will be on the right path. Also, being married make you not be so selfish. And, you know, I think me and Anuraj and Ronnie Kumari, we talked about that at his house, being this last child of my family. I got some very horrible selfish ways, you know. And being married to Roosevelt has really, you know, that selfishness creeps in every once in a while, and I want to do this one right. So I want to try to do, you know, do my very best. This one. Any other question? Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Yes. you were talking about you're reading from that book. I really, yes, I do want to get a copy of that myself.
Okay.
You're talking about a couple of things that has to do with being mastered, and I'll be paraphrasing, but I remember you saying that on the one hand that you may be ready to give up, to sacrifice your life. You're close to that. You think you could do that if necessary for your spiritual path.
Right.
And then, but before that, what you were saying was that if you're not even sure that you can give away your possessions. So I'm trying to see how could you say you could give away your life if you're not even sure you can give away your possessions, because and I understand what you're saying, because I feel the same way too off the top of my head, that yeah, I can give away all my stuff. I mean, I can give away my life and my spiritual path, but you know, don't ask me for my last dollar.
Right. Well, see, that's what I'm struggling with. And that's the unconsciousness that I'm in. That's that insanity that I'm dealing with. Because yes, it's insane to hold on to possessions and say, well, okay, I give my life. It's unequatable. It really is, because seeing my parents' death and dying, my mother was a fanatic on her jewelry and her china and all this other type of stuff. But when she was laying in Rainer's, and I had to do Thanksgiving meal, it's going, okay, Mom. You know, I was talking, I said, okay, Mom, well, you're not in your kitchen no more. I was crying because that impermanence of her leaving me and I had to do the cooking was on me. But then all her possessions was left. Okay, that was one glimpse. Then when Dad died, which was a couple of years ago, I got a glimpse again, because he wouldn't let nobody, now he'll buy your car, but you can't use his. he had all these stereos around him, but you can't use him. He'll buy you anything you wanted, because he was like the guru of gadgets. But he was attached to these things. And I saw that I got everything that belonged to him when he died. So I think I'm still working through the process of knowing that this stuff is no good, but my whole self is better than anything else that I can even have. You know, so I hope that kind of, because I'm still struggling very hard with that.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Oh. Pretty much where, yeah, and what I was hoping is that, and what I heard was that you see that is a paradox. That's a hard piece to struggle with.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay.
And you know, and I hope to get more conscious with that. You know, to go on and let stuff go, because I, you know, Gursal talked about impermanence, and I, you know, intellectually, yeah, I know, because I see the flowers, I see conversation, I see this and that leaving, but do I actually understand? No. I'm still dead in that situation. I'm still a walking zombie, as far as that. I want to become conscious of that. Yes, ma'am.
I had a different interpretation of the reading, I guess, because the life that I felt that they were talking about giving up was this ego. I think that we practice every day to die daily.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my interpretation of the reading versus giving up this physical life, because that's not a choice that you can make. It's going to go when it goes. But the life that I interpreted they were talking about giving up was the ego, the one that we attempt to do on a daily basis in our meditation. So, I mean, that might
have you look at
it a different way.
Right, but then we know that we suffer with these five perversions, don't we? Don't we suffer with them constantly?
All the time.
Okay, so yes, giving up the ego, but then the ego falls all the way into those five perversions.
Well, the five perversions are.
Okay, so then that goes back to that circle of what me and Baradaji.
Right. It's still a piece where I don't want to get that up either.
Right. I'm not
saying we want to bring it back.
Okay.
We want to attempt to base whatever our answers are or whatever the result of the question is, base it on the Dhamma and what the saints have said. We don't have to guess about it. What do the saints say about detachment? Because I think that's what the question is. Detachment, to detach from this life or possessions, one or the other, or ego. It's about detachment, and it's only one way to detach, as I understand the saints have said, and that's through Simran, Bhajan, and Dhyan. And that's the way that you detach. That's the way that you sacrifice, make any sacrifice of your ego, your possessions, or your life. So we don't want to guess about it or swing it around to one another for our own opinions, but also to always just go back to the Dhamma. The Dhamma answer all our questions. We can't answer these questions. We're not qualified. We're just going on our opinions and concepts. The saints tell you about detachment. So just to clear it up, to try to bring us back focused here to, you got a whole boo-hoo of Dhamma over there that answer all your questions or anybody else's questions.
You spoke about your emphasis on the path. And you spoke a lot about your emphasis on trying to make your marriage work. Have you really focused on Guru Sahib's teachings on how to make the marriage part of your spiritual practice? What is your understanding of how you can use this marriage to assist you in your spiritual practice?
Yeah, I'm still focusing on it now. You know, as we speak, I'm focusing on it, because that still goes into the ego and those perversions that I deal with on a constant basis. So, yes, I'm using it.
He is talked about that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And there's tapes that's available, and there's, I'm sure you have talked with him about this extensively. As to how to use. So I'm just wondering, because you did talk about your emphasis on the path and then the emphasis on marriage, and my question is, are you consciously aware of how to make one serve the other?
No. That's what I'm
trying to do, I should conscious.
Well, I'm trying to be conscious of trying to have that equilibrium. I don't have it right now. You know, I know that it's available, and I'm trying at it, but no, I don't have it as we speak. And I have not talked extensively to Gorsav about what's going on now. We you know, that's something that we're looking to the future to do with each other, because we really have it.
About that topic per se?
About that topic per se.
Because he even in terms of with me, trying to get to that point, but you know, he's given out a lot of on that, and so maybe you can revisit some of that, you know, really get a better understanding of how to make the marriage serve the path, because it is an opportunity to do that at the very basic and highest level.
Right, I've seen.
According to what he has, you know, put out.
Right, I heard some tapes on the household, because that's what I am, a householder. And some of the things that goes along with it, but I definitely need to revisit and to you know, to talk to him on that. Absolutely. Thank you for that.
That was helping me. You were trying to get to that point. It's helping me try to do it even at the relationship level. That's all that helps, truthfully. Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned the Driscoll's.
Yes, ma'am.
You started with the Bahada Drisky.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to that one, the guru mentioned another one. He didn't count them as one of the three, but he said that that one preceded all the rest of the three.
Okay.
So when you look again, mm-hmm. you'll see, you know, that one, because I think that was probably, that one he said leads to the rest, you know, leads into the rest of
them. Okay.
So.
Thank you. Everyone's question to the best of my ability today. Is there anything else that anyone likes? You know? Yes, ma'am.
Read your sad song so I can hear.
I'm going to blow you a kiss.
Yes.
Thank you.
we want to, before we break